My topic for today is collection of specimens for microbiology laboratory. So can you all of you hear me? Yes or no?
Yes,
okay. So can anybody tell me that what are the domains of a good microbiology laboratory? Because I know that most of you are familiar with pathology as well as biochemistry. But can anybody tell me that how relevant is a microbiology laboratory setup to hospital services? How relevant is it? How useful is it? What would you expect from a good laboratory? What do we do? Can anybody tell me, please? I'm not sure how many of you are really awake and listening to me, but you know, you are telling me that you can hear me. So can anybody very quickly give me one response? This is a huge drawback of online meetings.
Ma'am, I am from immunology department. Yeah. We get lot of patients with complicated infection because most of them will be under immunosuppression.
Yeah.
So good culture and
culture facility. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
So you know, a good culture facility is expected from any microbiology lab. So culture is something which only the microbiology laboratory does. Culture is not something which pathology puts up or biochemistry puts up. So culture for what? Can anybody tell me what do we culture for? What do we look for?
Bacteria, fungi.
Okay, bacteria, fungi. What else? What else? Okay, bacteria, fungi, then? Tuberculosis, Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Have all of you heard about that?
Yes,
ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so basically we are talking about infectious diseases. Am I right? You know, infectious diseases, not necessarily only in the immunocompromised host, but in healthy persons also, where there may be an infection at any site in the body. For example, it could be a UTI. What is the full form of UTI?
Urinary tract infection.
Okay, so there could be a UTI, there could be an RTI, which is a respiratory tract infection. There could be a CNS infection for which we could be sending CSF samples. If we are not doing cultures, even then we are putting up a number of tests by which we can do the lab diagnosis of infectious diseases. Currently, there is a pandemic going on. Where do you send the specimen for that testing? What is the name of that disease?
COVID-19.
Yeah, Dr. Raghu, yes.
Yeah, ma'am, lot many participants are not at all giving attention, I think.
I know, there are only 51 participants and no one is sub mute hai or video bhi nahi hai. I can't make out who's listening, doing what.
Okay, all the participants switch on their video.
Switch on your videos, all of you. Otherwise, you know, it is very wasteful to just talk and then you've hardly learned anything. And in the next 3 years, we'll be calling up all the time, all of you, trying to enlighten you about the kind of samples, the forms to be raised, what is test on and all that. So please try to understand, just 20-25 minutes of attention will give a lot of benefit to the patients whom you will be looking after.
Few of them have switched on their video cameras. So the rest of them, I think we should mark.
See, all those who do not switch on your camera, if you are not visible on the video, then you will be marked absent. Am I clear about this?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So please tell me, all of you now, I was just asking you that there's a pandemic going on and you are required to send specimens. Where would you like to send it to? Which lab?
For RT-PCR.
Right. RT-PCR, so that is a molecular diagnostic test. So as somebody said, first we talked about culture and molecular diagnostics, RT-PCR. Okay? So PCR tests are being performed for COVID diagnostics, swine flu, HIV, viral load testing. Okay, lab diagnosis. ELISAs. Can anybody tell me what is the full form of ELISA?
Enzyme-linked immunoobservant assay.
Enzyme-linked.
I know someone from immunology will tell. What about non-immunology person?
Enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay.
So I am sure that some of you may not be knowing what is the full form of an ELISA. So these are basic, you know, tests which you have to know about. डेंगी के लिए कब एलाइजा रेज करना है, कब पीसीआर रेज करना है, चिकन चिन्ना के लिए क्या करना है, एचआईवी के लिए कौन सा टेस्ट भेजना है, किस लैब में, सीरोलॉजी लैब क्या है, ट्यूबरक्लोसिस के डायग्नोसिस में कौन से फॉर्म्स रेज करने, व्हाट आर द सैंपल्स दैट हैव टू बी सेंट. हैव ऑल ऑफ यू हर्ड अबाउट माइकोबैक्टीरियम ट्यूबरक्लोसिस?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I'll be coming to those few tests one by one, but I would just like to emphasize in the beginning only that if a physician is dependent upon the microbiology laboratory data to save his patient, then the person who's collecting the specimen may determine the course of the patient recovery. So now you may say that, ma'am, you see the sisters are doing the specimen collection. I'm not able to change my slides. Okay. So what you have to do is you have to make sure that you even enlighten or educate the sisters who are collecting the sample. I'll give you a very small example at the beginning of my class only, that this is, you know, a sample and a form, two forms that we received on a half day, that is a Saturday. You can see that the forms have been raised for diagnosis of tuberculosis. One is for test on is pericardial fluid. The other test on is pleural fluid. However, we received just a single syringe. And we had no clue as to whether it was a pericardial fluid or a pleural fluid. So please understand that that all the samples have to be collected in a proper manner. The syringes have to be labeled. The containers have to be labeled appropriately. The form should match with the sample container. It is very, very important to do that. The other thing is that the biggest problem that we face is that when we call the concerned person, he usually says that my password is being used by somebody else. Now, what you are doing is, as new joinees, you are using a third year's password. So the requisition has been raised by Dr. XXX. When you call him on his CUG, he'll tell me, ma'am, I have no clue as to who is doing it because I am doing my OPD duty and this patient is in the ward. So kindly contact Dr. XXX. When I contact Dr. XX, he will give me some third CUG and say, please, I am not taking care of this patient and don't disturb me on a half day, madam, because I am through an emergency. My patient is having, you know, some kind of cardiac arrest and I am sorry, I cannot help you. So you understand that it took us about 45 minutes to 1 hour on a half day to just receive the correct form and the samples. So first and foremost thing is the person who is collecting the sample has to be sure about the form that is being raised, the culture container or the syringe. With full aseptic precautions, the samples for microbiology have to be collected. They have to be correctly labeled. The barcoding should be there. The packing list should be generated. And then it should be sent to the department. Because you see, we are working with an HIS, a hospital information system, which is completely computerized. We have to accept the samples on the computer. We have to make sure the payments are there, and then only after accepting the samples, we can validate the report. Many times it happens that there is one sample and there are three forms that are raised. Multiple, it has to go to mycology also, it has to go to bacteriology also, and it has to come to tuberculosis lab also. Now, please do not start dividing the samples at your end because they are likely to get contaminated. But make sure that you send all the three forms also. Because what happens now? Then somebody will call us after 2 days and say, ki, madam, it has been accepted in mycology lab, but it is not accepted in bacteriology. Or it is not accepted in tuberculosis. But you tell me, if we do not get the form, then how am I going to know that that test has to be done? That form has to come to the lab. If it keeps lying in the computer and printout is not taken and sent to the sections, how am I going to know that this test has to be done for TB also? Then only I can retrieve the sample and take it. So try to understand these are not minor issues, okay? These are small problems, everyday problems, which only residents can troubleshoot, and it can be troubleshooted or taken care of by a good coordination between the residents who are in the ward or in the OPD or at the sample collection end and the concerned laboratory where the sample is being sent. So we all have good, you know, landline phones. Everyone has a COG. If there is a precious sample, then please coordinate with the lab. If the sample has to be divided between pathology and microbiology, even then you should coordinate with the lab. And please remember that all samples for culture have to be put in normal saline and not in formalin. You know, a very common error is that tissue bits, OT biopsy specimens, all of them are put in formalin and then they are sent to microbiology to get a culture done. See, all the microorganisms die because of the formalin. It is not possible for us to process formalin specimens. So please coordinate between pathology and microbiology. Never send samples to the microbiology lab in formalin for culture. Okay. So specimens submitted for microbiological testing require proper handling from the time of collection through all stages of transport, storage, and processing. They should be collected in such a way that contamination by indigenous flora is minimized. This is especially true for blood cultures. So skin antisepsis, skin sepsis is very important. Otherwise, coagulase negative staphylococci or other candida species are common skin contaminants which will outgrow the pathogen. They will grow more quickly, much faster, and we will get a wrong report. Always avoid taking swabs. Take biopsy samples. Deep aspirates, try to collect samples in syringes because that is the best way of retrieving the pathogen. So what are the important questions that you should ask before you are collecting a sample for microbiology? Are you suspecting an infection? Then what is the nature of the infection? Is it fungal? For example, if a patient, you are suspecting meningitis. So is it an acute meningitis or a chronic meningitis? Then again, according to the history and the profile of the patient, could it be a viral meningitis or a cryptococcal meningitis or an acute bacterial meningitis or maybe a tubercular meningitis, because CSF sample is precious. Now, please don't send us 2 ml of CSF and then ask us to perform cultures for bacteria, virus, fungus, TB, everything. It is not possible. So you have to judiciously decide clinically that what is the infection that you are suspecting. If you are suspecting fungal meningitis, better to go for antigen testing for cryptococcus and culture and India Inc. wet mount for mycology. If you are suspecting acute bacterial meningitis, best is to send it to bacteriology. If the patient has a chronic history and it could be TB meningitis with on and off fever, then send it for mycobacteriology and especially the gene expert assay. Right? Is that clear? Are you hearing, all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then have you all become familiar with the hospital information system? Do you all know how to raise forms?
Yes, ma'am.
Or do you have data entry operators at your end who are doing all the work? Because that is also a huge drawback.
Yes, ma'am.
Even if you are taking help from an operator, it is all right. But you should know the basics of HIS. Do you all know how to raise a form?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so what is CPOE? Can anybody tell me what is CPOE? See, just now you told me that you are familiar with the HIS. So as
we raise forms by selecting that CPOE.
So what is CPOE? It is written on the left side of my screen. It is written EMR, OP consultation, EMR and CPOE. So what is CPOE?
Ma'am, patient order something.
Computerized
patient order entry. All right. So this is the window through which you have to go. And what you have to do is, for microbiology part, you have to select the laboratory. So this is, are you all familiar with this window? This is the window which comes? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am.
Then what you do is, you go to the department, you select whether it is microbiology, pathology, radiology, nuclear medicine. You go to the service center and take a drop down, right? Do you all know about this? You select the particular test, especially in bacteriology, there are multiple tests. So you have to understand what are the automated tests and which ones are the routine tests? Microscopy is relevant to all the samples except catheters. We do not do a microscopy from catheters. And never send a Foley's catheter for culture. A Foley's catheter only gives the contaminant flora. It will never tell you about the true pathogen. Okay? So microscopy for urine, microscopy for sputum. Try to understand routine tests are bacterial culture and sensitivity. Wherever BACTEC is written, it is an automated identification system. So BACTEC is specially good for blood cultures. Have you all heard about blood cultures?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Please tell, what are blood cultures for? What are they for? Please tell. Can you name any disease for which blood cultures are very important? Especially in which setting would you like to give blood cultures?
Infective endocarditis.
Very good. Okay, infective endocarditis is one condition. Where, how many blood cultures would you like to collect for infective endocarditis?
Three cultures.
See, no, five. At least five cultures you must take. Minimum three. And how? What is the volume of blood that you put in the bottles? Have you all seen the culture bottles? What are the culture bottles? Please tell. Bataiye bhai, are you awake? Now tell me, what are the, how many bottles are there for blood culture? First tell me that. Huh?
Aerobic, anaerobic.
Yeah, so there's an aerobic culture bottle and there is an anaerobic culture bottle. So there's an orange colored bottle and there's a blue colored bottle. Are there any pediatric vials also? Yes or no?
Don't know, ma'am.
Okay, so there's a pediatric vial also which has a slight pink color, all right? In which, why there's a pediatric vial? Because we cannot withdraw a lot of volume of blood from children, from pediatric patients, so a lesser 3 to 5 ml volume may be withdrawn. What is the optimum volume for an adult blood culture bottle? How much volume of blood should be collected?
10 ml.
Yeah, 8 to 10 ml. 8 to 10 ml in each bottle. So that makes a total collection of 20 ml, right? Is that clear to all of you?
Okay.
So BACTEC, see, BACTEC can be put up for pus also, especially if you are suspecting monomicrobial infection. What does monomicrobial mean? Bataiye bhai, jaldi jaldi, aise to we'll go on teaching for 2 hours, huh?
Only one organism is expected.
Yeah, there's a single organism. So deep-seated pus, abscess, monomicrobial. Polymicrobial pus hame kis tarah ke infection mein milega? Can you give an example?
Peritonitis.
Peritonitis, okay. That can be polymicrobial. What else? Diabetic foot. Diabetic foot infections are also usually polymicrobial, right? So what I'm trying to tell you is that blood cultures, but we do not raise, you know, we raise blood cultures for those samples for which we need rapid growth. When patient is, apart from infective endocarditis, the patient is very sick. The patient is in bacteremia, in sepsis, for critically ill patients, patients in CCM admitted, where we would like to have the organism quickly. All right, especially in typhoid fever, where we recover salmonella. So these are the kind of infections for which BACTEC blood cultures are sent. We should never raise forms for BACTEC in urine samples, in which, and in those pus samples which are likely to be polymicrobial. Then throat swab. Swab sticks for which automated culture is not required. We cannot process throat swab for BACTEC culture. Am I clear to all of you? See, these are the common mistakes which all of you make, and you have to be clear that what is the test, what is the form, what is the test on, okay? For sputum, deep, cogged out, you know, expectorated sputum should come, which should be sent for routine culture, not BACTEC culture, because then it will be contaminated by the upper respiratory tract flora. So automated cultures are for blood. They could be for CSF. They are when we need a rapid diagnosis, when the patient is very sick, we want to know the organism for sepsis or for infective endocarditis. We should never raise them for urine because urine, commonly rapid growing bacteria are there, E. coli, Enterococcus, they will grow overnight on cultures. And bacteric cultures are much more expensive also. Then we have a MIC, automated bacterial identification and sensitivity testing test also. This we perform sensitivity by Vitek or automated equipments. So this is also relevant to critically ill patients where you have to monitor the dose or modulate the dose according to the minimal inhibitory concentration. I'm not going into the details because there is not so much of time. But the MIC is the minimal inhibitory concentration according to which you can regulate the dose of the drug, and it is specially important for CCM patients. Anybody from critical care, DM wale koi nahi hai, critical care wale? New SRs, I think they four students have joined. Koi hai? DM wale? DM CCM wale nahi hai? Students?
Yes, yes.
Huh? So tell bhai, dekho, this is very important for you, I am telling you. All right. In fact, you should request somebody in your department to take a class on microbiology specimen collection. Okay. Any passing out third year? All right. Who can help you with specimen collection? It is very important. Very important dimension for CCM students. So raise. Now, what is the other important point that has to be kept in mind? Raise forms for both microscopy and culture. See, what is the name of the stain that we do in microbiology?
Gram stain.
Yeah. So a Gram stain gives you a huge vital idea regarding the choice of empirical antibiotic therapy. So either you can see Gram positive bacteria or Gram negative bacilli, or maybe when you are sending for tuberculosis, you can see acid fast bacilli. AFB staining we can do. We can do fungal stains, India Inc. for Cryptococcus. So even though even if you don't raise a form for microscopy, we do microscopy on all these samples. So it is very critical to have an idea regarding the number of pus cells and the staining of the organism, because it will help you in choosing your empirical antibiotic coverage for those 3 to 5 days when the final culture report does not come. So suppose you see a gram-positive cocci only, you have an idea that this could be staphylococcus or it could be enterococcus if they are in chains. You can tentatively ask the lab. It is also very important for CSF. Gram stain of CSF is very, very critical. Gram stain of pus samples for tracheal aspirates regarding, you know, with reference to the pus cells and the staining of the organism, you can start your empirical antibiotic treatment. Now coming to the divisions that we have, as I mentioned before, bacteriology, mycology, parasitology, serology, and microbial immunology or virology, mycobacteriology, hospital surveillance, and infection control. So these are the clinical microbiology domains that we have in a laboratory. Now, as I told you before, what are the tests that you can raise in bacteriology? I'll not repeat it. We have gone through it. Microscopy, a must for all samples except tips of catheters. Then bacterial culture and sensitivity, routine aerobic and anaerobic. Very relevant for sputum samples. Bactec, automated, either aerobic and anaerobic. Ideally, you should send it as a set of blood culture, means you are inoculating both the bottles, 8 to 10 ml in aerobic bottle and 8 to 10 ml in the anaerobic bottle. Since most of the bacteria are aerobes as well as facultative anaerobes, see, bacteremia by anaerobic organisms is very rare. But what happens, because most of the bacteria are aerobes as well as facultative anaerobes, generally the growth comes earlier in the anaerobic bottle. This is what we have seen. Plus, if same organism grows in both the bottles, you are sure of the infection. Is that clear to all of you? The other test is the automated bacterial identification and sensitivity testing and the procalcitonin SC, again for patients in sepsis. Tuberculosis, microscopy tuberculosis, we have both solid as well as liquid culture. The staining is done by acid fast method. Solid culture and liquid cultures, both are being done. Gene, how many of you have heard about the gene expert assay? What is it? Can anybody tell me? At the beginning of the class, you spoke about RT-PCR. So can anybody tell me how many of you have actually heard about the gene expert assay? What is it about? Quickly tell, please. It's past four. बताइए
डायग्नोसिस ऑफ ट्यूबरकुलोसिस में
एंड अरे वो तो जब लिखा है वहां पे तो टीबी ही ना डायग्नोस करेंगे और कुछ थोड़ी करेंगे फंगस थोड़ी डायग्नोस
स्पेसिफिक जीन्स ऑफ एमटीबी एंड सो दैट इज व्हाई इट इज स्पेसिफिक फॉर एमटीबी
व्हाट एल्स डज इट टेल यू व्हाट इज द वैल्यू ऑफ दिस एसे इज इट ओनली अ रैपिड डायग्नोसिस
एंड ड्रग रेजिस्टेंस यू कैन चेक रेजिस्टेंस
आल्सो हां रेजिस्टेंस टू व्हाट Can anybody tell me what is the percentage of drug resistance for tuberculosis in India? What does the recent WHO data tell us? Pulmonary tuberculosis mein, what is multi-drug resistance? Can anybody tell me? What are the two main drugs for treating?
Rifampicin and isoniazid.
Rifampicin and isoniazid. So what is MDR? पॉली ड्रग रेजिस्टेंस है मल्टी ड्रग रेजिस्टेंस है प्री एक्सडीआर है एक्सडीआर क्या है एक्सडीआर का फुल फॉर्म क्या है एक्सटेंसिव ड्रग रेजिस्टेंस ठीक है तो प्री एक्सडीआर भी है एक्सडीआर भी सो ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड वी इंडिया इज इन द मिडल ऑफ एन एपिडेमिक ऑफ एमडीआर टीवी We are having an epidemic. ठीक है, you read recent published data. Pulmonary tuberculosis में the rate of multi-drug resistance is about 20%. All right, and it is projected that in the next 10 years, about 33% of primary cases will be multi-drug resistant. So we need a rapid diagnostic test which can tell us about the susceptibility to rifampicin as well. So this is a huge advantage this test has. And what is the turnaround time? In how much time do you get the report?
120 minutes.
So, okay, 2 hours, right? So about 2 to 2.5 hours, the time it takes to load the cartridge, process labeling, etc. Usually our turnaround time is about 3-4 hours. Like suppose you send it in pre-lunch, we'll give you the report by 3. If it doesn't get very late and the samples come by 2, we give you the report by 5. Okay. So what I'm trying to tell you is that rifampicin RPOB gene ko target karta hai ye PCR se. Theek hai? It's a real-time based PCR assay. RPOB gene ko target karta hai aur MTBC ko detect karta hai, identify karta hai and it gives you the sensitivity or resistance to rifampicin as well. Now, if a sample is resistant to rifampicin, then there is usually INH resistance also in 85% of cases. So it becomes a surrogate marker for resistance testing to INH also. Do you get it? So this is a huge advantage because conventional culture, now these days, just think that I am sending my gene expert report before I validate the microscopy. Because for microscopy, I have to stain the slide, I have to dry it, which takes about 1 to 1.5 hours. And I do it at one go along with the decontamination and culture processing. So by the time the slide dries and gets stained and again dries, usually we are able to send the microscopy report on the second day. All right, at least for the post-lunch samples. But this is an assay where there is no prior processing involved. Nothing you have to do. You just have to divide the sample, load it in the cartridge, put it on the machine. And within 2 hours, it is very good for sputum and bowel samples. For pulmonary tuberculosis, and why for specially pulmonary? Because these are the cases which are going to transmit the infection. These are the ones who are going to spread the infection. And the results are very good for extrapulmonary TB also, even for FNAC samples, pus samples, abscesses. Apart from Mycobacterium tuberculosis, we have a lot of atypical mycobacteria also. Maybe the immunology people, you know, who are listening today, they will gradually realize over time that with the immunosuppressed population, malignancy patients, other patients who are on steroids for immunosuppressive therapy, there's a lot of atypical mycobacteria also that we are diagnosing, especially abscesses, fortuitum. All right. Then there is the line probe assay. This is another assay which we put up on culture, though it can be done on smear positive samples. The advantage is that it will simultaneously give you the sensitivity to rifampicin as well as INH. In case there is mono INH resistance, which happens in 10 to 12% of cases, then we can detect mono INH resistance also. So suppose a gene expert is giving you a rifampicin sensitive assay, but after 3-4 months of treatment, the patient is not improving, your CT pictures are not clearing, whatever improvement you are expecting clinically is not happening, then you can suspect mono INH resistance also. If the culture comes positive, then we can look for this INH resistance. The usual turnaround time for TB culture is 6 to 8 weeks. So by that time, the patient is already on a wrong regimen. Patient becomes lost to follow-up. Patient is not convinced about the treatment and may stop coming. You are giving a drug sensitive regimen. The patient is not improving. He stops coming to the doctor. So imagine the, and that too, when the culture comes positive, you have to wait for another 4 to 6 weeks for the susceptibility to come, because again, that is done by the culture method. And here we have a molecular test, which is going to tell you about the drug resistance status within 2 hours. All right. Then similarly, there's a line probe assay for second line drugs also. Then real-time PCR also we are doing, and we are doing microscopy for M. leprae also at the tuberculosis lab. Tests for parasitology are for malaria, microfilaria, plasmodium. Microscopy is stool and opportunistic pathogens. So for all those residents who are especially from nephrology, post renal transplant recipients, we have a lot of cryptosporidium and microsporidia. So stool specimens, especially in that immunosuppressed population where patient's diarrhea is not improving and you send stool specimens, we definitely look for opportunistic pathogens such as cryptosporidium and microsporidia, okay? Then bacterial cultures are done. ELISA is put up for Clostridium difficile toxin also, okay? In mycology, microscopy, culture, cryptococcal antigen agglutination test is put up, which is very sensitive and specific. In fact, it is much more sensitive and specific than similar to the microscopy for that antigen test for malaria detection, which we do. All right. Then what other things you have to remember? Do not raise multiple tests on the same order number. Do not raise anaerobic cultures for sputum, tracheal aspirates and urine. Do not raise forms for microscopy in blood culture or CVP tip samples. Always add the name of the sample in the testron sample, and it is very useful if you tell us about the site of collection also. Many times testron says pus. Pus from where? Which region? We are able to, you know, correlate well if you put on the site as well as the testron. And a brief clinical diagnosis, suspected. Okay. Then you can use order remarks for additional comments and order MIC testing for very sick patients. Then volume of the specimen. As I told you, volume of the specimen is very important, 8 to 10 ml for blood cultures. CSF samples are precious. We should not be asked to perform cultures for anaerobes, for fungus, for tuberculosis collected on swabs or few drops of fluid. It is very difficult. Collect as much volume of fluid as is possible. Always send tissue bits and biopsy samples in normal saline, never in formalin. Volume is very critical for blood cultures and also of mycobacterial cultures from CSF and urine. There is a lot of genitourinary tuberculosis which residents seem to miss. Urology people, please note, nephrology people, please note that urine for tuberculosis, for genitourinary tuberculosis, if you are suspecting in a patient who has fever, weight loss, you know, bacterial cultures are coming negative. Patient, you know, I have come across staff patients for 2 to 3 years. They are giving chronic history of fever, burning, micturition. Bacterial culture is coming sterile and they don't know what to do. They never suspect that the patient can have genitourinary tuberculosis. Even there are, you know, you do that MCU test. Nothing comes out of investigation in urology, but for 2 years, 1.5 years, the patient is roaming around, giving repeated, you know, bacterial tests, complaining of burning, micturition, pain, and yet you are not suspecting TB of the urinary tract. So please make sure that suspect genitourinary tuberculosis in patients who have taken multiple rounds of antibiotic, who are persisting with the burning micturition, bacterial cultures are coming sterile, and the patient is also harassed, you don't know what to do. Other thing to remember is that cultures for urine and tuberculosis have to be collected in 3 glass bottles that are available from the lab. I hope all of you are not doing sleeping. Please give some answers. How do you collect cultures for urine and TB lab? Tell. Huh? Sabka kitno ka video off hai? See, I don't want to waste my time also.
Three separate glass vials, ma'am.
Glass containers, jam bottle jaisi hai. Unko 200 ml kam se kam bhar karke urine bhejiye. First morning urine voided, theek hai? Day 1, day 2, day 3. We do not perform gene expert on urine samples. Please remember that. It is very wasteful. The test costs 2500 rupees. It is of no value to the patient unless the urine is very turbid or has a lot of pus cells. The other thing is, if the patient is catheterized for bacterial cultures, you have to collect urine from the tubing and not from the bag. For TB, you can collect the sample from the bag, but not for bacteriology specimens. All right, always clamp the catheter, take a sterile, clean the catheter tubing aseptically, take a sterile syringe, aspirate the urine, put it in a urine container, and then send it to the lab. Is that clear? All right.
Yes, ma'am.
And I have already told you about the samples. Pus, urine, blood, CSF, sputum, tracheal aspirates. These are the samples that we have to look for. I have already told you about the gram stain. We can see gram positive cocci, gram negative bacilli, or even fungal elements on a gram stain along with the background of epithelial cells or pus cells. Acid fast bacilli for tuberculosis. All right, acid fast staining. This is a picture of the cultures that we put up in the lab. So, lab diagnosis in microbiology depends on the right specimen collected at the right time, transported in the right way to the right laboratory. Now, after having an idea about the correct sample, the form, the test on, the order remarks, the HIS, what about the transportation? We always remember, never refrigerate CSF. Never. Never refrigerate blood cultures. There is also a very common misconception, that the blood culture bottles have to be refrigerated if they are not being used. There's a shelf life to it, and it is clearly written that they can be kept at room temperature. So CSF and blood cultures are two samples which you are never going to refrigerate. Is that clear? All right. And the other guideline is that you always have to collect a sample of the patient before you give antibiotics. So collection of specimen before the administration of antimicrobial agents and prevention of contamination of the sample with externally present organisms. All right. So these are some of the principles which I have told you. Never refrigerate CSF or blood culture. Sterile leak-proof containers have to be sent to the laboratory. What is unacceptable? Unlabeled specimens, leaking, broken, cracked containers, visual contamination, unpreserved samples, and sample which does not match with the test. I'll just show you a few, I'll not go into the details of blood cultures. These are the automated bottles that we have. We have stopped using the routine culture bottles now. So as you can see, the first one is the pediatric vial. Can all of you see? The first one is the pediatric vial. The second one is the aerobic vial, and the third orange cap is the anaerobic vial. Now, can all of you recognize it? And please avoid putting the stickers on the barcode because the machine reads it. The most other common error is that you put the sticker on the barcode, which then does not allow us to scan with the barcode of the machine. All right? So, I will just, show you the containers. These are the normal sputum or urine containers. Deep, well-expectorated sputum has to be collected. Midstream urine clean cat specimen has to be collected to avoid contamination. The patient has to be, asked for correction of urine. The patient should be asked to mildly clean the, the local area and then void the urine. The midstream urine has to be put in the container and then the container has to be closed. So these containers can be used for both sputum and urine or any kind of aspirates that you can put. Foley's catheter tips are unsuitable. They are always rejected. Then never collect urine from the collection bag for bacteriology. It will always lead to contamination. Suprapubic aspiration of urine from bladder can be done in pediatric patients. CSF, I have already told you, there is a lumbar puncture process. You can send it for cryptococcal antigen detection, whether it is fungal meningitis, bacterial meningitis, or TB meningitis. Never refrigerate CSF and obtain blood for cultures also. All right, the maximum volume is recommended. For upper respiratory tract infections, throat swab, nasal swab, nasopharyngeal swabs can be sent most commonly. Nasal swabs for COVID testing especially, these are the swab kits that are available. They can be taken from the lab as well as the viral transport medium. You have to break the stick and put it in the medium and then send it to the lab with the appropriate forms. Throat swab has a definite procedure. I'll not go into the details of that. A nasal swab can also be collected easily. Nasopharyngeal swab can also be collected. For lower respiratory tract infections, sputum and bile, which is very important for tuberculosis. All right. So deep coughed out sputum should be taken. Gastrointestinal infections, either you can send stool or biopsy samples or even rectal swabs may be taken. All right. Then these are the stool containers that are available from the lab. You can take them. They have a spoon at the end for taking out the sample. Rectal swabs can be collected. Genitourinary samples, for genital, we have vaginal swabs that are sent usually to us from the MRH and gynecology specimens. So, I hope all of you have been attentive and you have understood. So, accurate results are possible only when the specimens are collected, transported and stored properly. And cultures are less likely to be contaminated and will yield pathogens if we are careful about the instructions that I have given you today. Are there any questions now?